Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory. Great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee, which is so important and more important than ever. And a great service department that takes care of everything for you. Great service department. Fabulous service department that takes care of everything for you. Inspections, routine, diagnostics, you name it, they can handle it all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Great to be with you on the show today. I know that, Matt, you always like to open the show with your perspective on life, a.k.a. sports.
Right, yes.
What is today's perspective?
Well, today's perspective, well, I am happy about the Yankees bouncing back last night.
Okay, they beat a Triple-A team.
I know.
That's not good. It's not like you went out and beat a legitimate Major League team. It's not, okay.
But I am excited that we'll see Penn State on CBS for the first time since 2000 for the Auburn game.
That's nice.
That'll be fun. Then hopefully our buddy Brad Nessler should be on the call, and we'll have to get him on.
Yeah, no, that's good. Been a while since Brad's done a Penn State game. Yeah, no, that'll be really good.
But I really don't have much complaints today. I'm pretty good as far as the sports end goes.
Really? Wow.
I mean, I'm disappointed that Andy Weidl is leaving the Eagles because he's going to be the new Steelers assistant GM, but I kind of saw that coming.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, can't keep your people. I mean, you know, that's a big issue. I mean, you can't keep your people. Simple as that. I'm just joking.
But if the Eagles can get Brandon Hunt, because it looks like he's on his way out of Pittsburgh with the way things have occurred, and that would be a nice little
What's interesting about the Hunt thing is this, is that part of what I you get the impression that they kind of felt like he needed more seasoning. And that was part of, like, why, in the end, he didn't get it. No, I don't, you know, I'm not around them enough to know that. I'm not going to sit here and pretend I know a lot about Brandon Hunt, you know, because I really don't. Typical Eagles fans, you'll be sitting there touting his praises and know nothing about him, but that's all right. Tell me I'm wrong.
Are you talking about Brandon Hunt or Andy Weidl?
Both.
Well, we knew about Andy Weidl when he first came in. We knew where he came from, under the Ozzie Newsome tree.
And
we loved it. It's why we don't want to see him go. I mean, he's had... I don't really blame a whole lot of the Eagles' draft issues on him necessarily, because as the more and more you found out, the more and more it was on the coaches and Howie making the calls, the final decisions, than it was on the scouting department. Like the Justin Jefferson thing, for instance.
Wait, you're saying that the scouting department made a mistake on Justin Jefferson?
No. They wanted to pick Justin Jefferson. It was the coaches and Howie that were all high on Jalen Reagor. and they overrided the scouts and picked Jalen Reagor.
Well, no wonder the guy left and quit and went to the Steelers. Just kidding you. Well, these guys, I mean, they make the personnel decisions. I mean, there's no getting around it. They make the personnel decisions. I mean, the coaches don't really have as much to do with that. I mean, they have some, but not a ton to do with it. And, yeah. So that's a, you know, big loss. But, yeah, most people don't know who half these people are. Really? Okay, great. Well, I hope he does well in Pittsburgh. We like them. All right. Got to tell you one of the great Ray Didinger stories since we had Ray on the show yesterday. Okay. And that deals, and you'll love this topic. This is right up your alley. You're going to love this, okay? Because it really is, I mean, he is the week of the Super Bowl. Now, we all know Ray is one of those guys that does not lose his cool, right? That's one of the things that people appreciate about him, is that he has the ability to look at any situation, and for the most part, he has the ability to kind of look at it and go, okay. And be very level-headed about it, right? That's Ray. So he's on with the Boston media guys, and you've heard my brother talk about the Boston media guys a lot, right?
Yes, they're nauseating, yes.
And so in doing this, they bring up what I always kid you about. And you know, of course, I'm kidding you, right?
Yes, the going Santa Claus, yes.
Kidding around about the fans and Santa Claus.
Correct.
And the whole thing, right? Okay. So they bring up the fan base. And Ray is ultra sensitive about the Eagles fan base, as we all know. Look, he's a Philly guy. He grew up there, you know? He's like, you're going to put down my fan base? You got to be kidding me. Don't do that. Well, the Boston guys, of course, trying to get a rise out of him, bring it up. You got to admit, you guys are an easy target.
Yeah. Let's just say there's still some things, like other fan bases, that I'm not proud of.
No. I'm just saying.
Yes, it is an easy target. I'll give you that.
It's an easy target on a talk show. How about that?
Yes.
Okay? Simple as that. It just is. I'm not, you know, it's just the way it's always worked out. All right. Got it. And so he sits there, and of course, he listens to what they have to say. And he's had enough. And I guess he let him have it. He let them have it. He says the Eagles fan base is always there. Which they are. They're always there. No matter what. We can kid around all we want, but the Eagles fan base is always there. They love their team. They're into their team. They are always highly opinionated about their team. But the last thing you do is you put down their team. Right? Fair?
Absolutely.
Okay. And he looked at the hosts of the show. And like I said, as Kevin talks about them all the time, I mean, they are a boisterous know-it-all, you know, way smarter than you group. And he says, what are you talking about? He says, in your town, let's be honest about it. He said, in your town, he said, nobody even knew it before Belichick and Brady who the heck you people were. He said, nobody knew anything about Boston as a football town. He says, people in Boston didn't know about Boston as a football town, which he's right. Absolutely. That is an absolutely true statement. And he said, and you guys, so all you guys did, he says, is that all of a sudden everybody jumped on the bandwagon when the Patriots started winning. He says, you didn't even know he had a team in Foxborough. I mean, you would have loved it.
I actually remember hearing about this. I applauded him then, and I still applaud him now.
It was really fabulous. It wasn't just good, it was fabulous what he did. And he's right. He's right. I mean, and you know, just because I grew up in New England doesn't mean I'm not fair about what goes on in various cities, towns, and so forth when stuff happens. And that's the way, and he wasn't wrong. Ray wasn't wrong. That's the way Boston is. Oh, yeah, we love the Patriots. Oh, yeah. You know, for God's sakes. Yeah. So, you know, I've always told you about the myth about the Red Sox. And it is, you know, and it's part myth. Oh, they sell out every game, the whole thing, for God's sakes. You know, there were fewer than 10,000 people there when Ted Williams hit his last home run that everybody talks about with such great affection and lore. There were fewer than 10,000 people there. In the 60s and early 70s, Matt, I could have gotten a ticket to any Red Sox game I wanted. Any Red Sox game I wanted, I could have got a ticket to. Because that's the way it was. That is the way it was. And, you know, and it's because that's the reality of it. That's the reality of it. You know? Eagles fans, look, I give the Philly fans all the credit in the world for, I think that Eagles fans are great fans. They're really into what's going on with their team. They love their team. No ifs, ands, or buts, okay? None. Zero. Zip. Zilch. Okay? I think that Flyers fans, for the most part, were great most of those years. Now they've become, I mean, there are a lot of empty seats now. In part because, look, let's be honest, the Flyers have not done anything to get the fans excited. They just haven't. And that's just a fact. That's not a rip or anything like that. It's just a fact. And that is... But Eagles fans don't just like their team. They love their team. And whenever they criticize them because of the passion they have for it. In Boston, all those years, nobody knew what was going on with the Patriots, for goodness sakes. Until Robert Kraft came along, the Patriots almost moved to St. Louis. You know that? Jim Ortwine was the owner of the Patriots. He almost moved to St. Louis. That was going to be it. They were going to move. He wasn't going to keep them there. Until Kraft came along, Kraft kind of saved the whole thing. Kraft saved the whole thing. And that's just that, I mean, that's fact. I mean, that is an absolute fact. And that's, you know, that's the way it was in New England. And Ray was right. You know, on the body, oh, yeah, you know, we're great, we're incredible, you know, look, we got Brady, we got Belichick. Goodness sakes, when you're... I'll give you a good example about where the Patriots were. WBZ in Boston decided to do a Legends of Boston broadcast, okay? And in doing that, they needed to get... You need to get Legends of Boston on the show. So they got Larry Bird, again, you know, they got Larry Bird. They got Bobby Orr. They got, I think it was Ted Williams. And you know who represented the Patriots? Steve Grogan. That's how bad they were. And I mean that with all due respect to Steve Grogan, by the way.
That's a name for you, Steve Grogan, man.
But he was the face of the franchise.
Yes.
Okay, that's my point. My point is, he was the face of the franchise. All right? And that is where they were as a franchise. That's where they were. And so, you know, yeah, the Patriots have had a great... So, in other words, ever since you've been around and alive, the Patriots have been, okay, whatever. They've been, you know, among the best in any business. But to be honest with you, before then, people in Boston did not give a darn. I mean, look, the NFL forced them. The NFL forced them to build Schaefer Stadium. They said, we're not going to let you in if you're playing at Fenway Park. We're not going to let you in if you're playing at Fenway Park. And they played at Harvard, Boston University, and Fenway Park when they were in the AFL. And Schaefer Stadium, which then became Sullivan Stadium, and then they eventually tore it down. They built Gillette. Now, Gillette's a gorgeous stadium. I mean, Gillette is a beautiful stadium. And that, you know, and Kraft built that. The only thing Kraft asked for was he wanted $72 million for infrastructure. And the Massachusetts legislature turned him down. That's when Kraft threatened to move them to Hartford. Okay? Well, you know, this is I'll kid you about Eagles fans all the time because I'm just having fun with you. But look, the passion, you can't duplicate the passion in Philadelphia. You just can't. And Ray let him have it, but good. You loved it. It was legendary. And for a guy that doesn't normally lose his temper about stuff, I mean, he let him have it.
Oh, yeah, I remember it. It was awesome.
Because he represented people like you.
That's right.
The downtrodden. We'll come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Let's give New England credit for one area. They cheer Santa Claus.
Sure, I'll give them that. But see, then they probably boo Santa Claus, though, if they... They probably boo Santa Claus if they actually gave him coal because that's how spoiled they are up there.
Winning does that to you.
I know. That's why we don't take it for granted in Philly.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best in new inventory. Great pre-owned inventory, all with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. And a great service department that takes care of inspections, routine, diagnostics, whatever it may be. It is all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Great to go to Pittsburgh now and be joined by Chris Mack. Chris, welcome back. Great to have you with us.
Thanks for having me, Steve. How are you?
I'm doing great. I will stay away from the Pirates because I want to keep this positive.
Good idea.
Brutal. They're brutal. All right, Omar Khan, no surprise. I think I made the comment the other day, the leader in the clubhouse. Chris, give everyone an idea about how this guy has paid his dues to get to this point.
Omar Khan is, for lack of a better way to put it, a Steelers lifer, and that's meant as a compliment. Other than a year or two, I want to say, interning with the Saints in his hometown, New Orleans, about 20 years ago, his entire football career has been spent in the Pittsburgh Steelers front office. He is the guy that made it cap manageable for them to put together a roster around Ben Roethlisberger's ever-increasing salary throughout the last decade and a half. He's the man who's helped construct the T.J. Watt contract extension, who will help construct the Minkah Fitzpatrick contract extension, the guy who helped keep what was then a sane Antonio Brown in Pittsburgh as long as they did with the financial commitment they gave him at the time. This guy was Kevin Colbert's capologist, and he's going to go forward being Andy Weidel's capologist, as it sounds like Andy Weidl, VP of player personnel down in Philly, is most likely going to be hired as the assistant GM. I shouldn't say most likely. It's going to happen. It just hasn't been officially reported yet.
Yes.
So Andy's going to be the football guy, much like Kevin was the football guy. Andy, very similar to Kevin, a Pittsburgh guy who went off and, you know, cut his teeth in another place. Kevin Colbert did it in Detroit, Andy in Baltimore and Philly, and is now coming home to work for the hometown Steelers. And he'll be the football guy while Omar helps run the financials. And then, you know, the one part of this that shouldn't be lost on anybody is that, you know, the ever-increasing role of Mike Tomlin, a guy who's going into his 16th year in the league, and, you know, when he first started was probably just an old X's and O's ball coach, but has increasingly become that CEO type who wants to know what the ingredients are going to be in his soup, and is definitely helping make some of those big decisions on personnel matters.
Yeah, I give Andy White a lot of credit. He actually thought Justin Jefferson was better than Jalen Reagor. So he got overruled.
That's going to be a huge difference, I think, for Andy. And, you know, I've talked to some people that are close to what that situation was like out in Philly. And, you know, Howie Roseman, love him or hate him, doesn't sound like a peach to work for all the time. So this is going to be very different for Andy. I don't know. You know, Andy gets a reputation as a guy who believes in the players that he has seen, to the point that, you know, as you're talking, you give a great example, the Reagor Jefferson debate that raged on in that war room on that draft day. And you know, Andy wanted his guy and was willing to go to bat for his guy. He very often is, and I don't know if it's going to be nearly as combative in the Steelers front office.
Right.
Not to say that they won't have disagreements,
right,
but
sure,
you know, it's a very collaborative atmosphere down on the south side, and it has been for a long time. You know, Kevin Colbert doesn't make any decisions in a vacuum without input, like I said, from Mike Tomlin, Omar Khan, Brandon Hunt, who, you know, we can get to, will probably be on his way out of Pittsburgh now with the addition of Andy. But yeah, it's going to be a very different working atmosphere for Andy, who, you know, has a very good relationship with Omar already, from what I understand, you know, going back to when Andy was working here in the scouting department years ago.
Brandon Hunt, the impression I got, and you can tell me if I'm wrong about this, is they didn't think he was quite experienced enough yet for this position. Is that accurate?
I don't know if it's that, Steve, or if it's – I've been told by some people that Brandon doesn't necessarily interview well. I don't know how to interpret that other than, and this is just my interpretation, we've all been in a situation where we expect to get a job, or we know somebody who's been in a situation where they had done enough time at a place and were familiar with everyone enough and had been, you know, gaining increasingly growing responsibilities, and they thought, well, the next logical progression is I'm going to get that promotion that I've really always wanted. And then they go into the interview, and maybe they're not quite as prepared as some of the other people because they thought it was just going to be a sit with the boss and shoot the mess kind of session. And that's, again, I don't have any inside information. I don't know if that's why Brandon was sort of leapfrogged by Andy in this process or not. But when you hear somebody say that Brandon, who by all accounts is well-respected, Yes. A ton of people in the organization like him and the job that he's done in building the roster, helping build the roster here, hasn't really even had his future addressed with the team yet. That tells you, I think, that, you know, for me, the only way that computes is if something went sideways in the interview process.
All right. I believe it was on your show that Doug Whaley made his comments about Jack.
Yes, it was. Sure. To which, now, if you were watching the video stream of our show, you saw the indignation on my face.
Yes, I did. Now, I'd like to point out that by all indications, you know, Doug, who's an Upper St. Clair guy, is very well liked by a lot of people.
Okay? He is.
This isn't personal with me at all. It really isn't. It's just comical that it's my broadcast working partner who's
right
in, like, every Hall of Fame on the planet. It's okay. All right. This is the, and I mentioned this earlier, this is the part that's struck me. Look, you and I both know that today's athlete is bigger, stronger, faster. I mean, every sport right now, because of off-season training, is right, has better athletes now than it ever has. I think that's fair, right?
Yes.
Okay. Right. This is what struck me about that. When I'm looking for a difference maker in a player, regardless of sport, okay, they're all close. So let's use a football example. He runs a 4.42. He runs a 4.46. Okay. So if you hold your hand about 4 inches apart, that's how close it is. I want to now know of the two of them, which one knows how to play. And when he made the comments about Jack, that told me he doesn't know how to look for guys who know how to play. He only knows about measurables.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I think Doug's comments were born more out of the idea that you wouldn't be able to take a player. We were comparing eras to his defense, because we had just got done talking about, you know, Mel Blunt, I think, right before that, or in that same conversation. I don't know how we got going down that path, but Doug's point was, I think, if I can speak for him a little bit, you know, guys who played in the 70s wouldn't be able to play in this day and age, or at least guys of a certain size wouldn't be able to play the same position. And that's the way I took it. Like, I think Jack, just based on his size, his athleticism, and his football IQ that you just mentioned, and Jack actually mentioned this on our station late last week, would be a great, like, weak side linebacker, hybrid safety, like the guys that are uber popular in football today, an oversized strong safety almost, right?
Yeah, because Jack played at 228. Whaley had his weight wrong, so.
Yeah, no, you're right, and I still think he'd be a Pro Bowler, an All Pro at that position if you pick Jack Ham up from 1970s Jack Ham and you drop him in 2022, give him today's nutrition and advanced athletic equipment. My God, yeah, Jack would still be at the very least a perennial All Pro. To just be at a different position. I think, you know, Doug is very good at. You may remember we had a conversation about LSU and USC and Mike Tomlin probably about 6 months ago. So Doug's very good at giving a for instance or an example, and in the way he phrases it, people latch onto it, and very quickly it's a hot button topic. So we thank him for that every Wednesday when he's on our show.
He did, but because the reaction, I watched the video. The two of you are like, "What the hell?"
Well, especially for me. And Doug, look, a lot of people made this accusation. It had nothing to do with the fact that Doug's a Pitt guy.
As
a Penn State guy, I mean, my brain melted a little bit faster when he said that. Hell, Jack could play today at his size. He might not have the same moves and the same quicks that he once had, but football smarts and size. I don't want to run
He's 72 now, Chris. He's 72 now. He couldn't play today. No.
Sure he could.
Actually, he could. It's interesting. You know, we talk about his weight. He played at 228, 229, somewhere right around there. He's about 10 to 12 pounds less now. I mean, he is in remarkable shape.
Oh, no. I mean, when I saw you guys last fall at the what forever will be known now as the Illinois game, unfortunately, it was.
I refer to it as that thing.
I was I hadn't seen Jack personally in years at that point, and I was still astonished at what great shape he looked to be in. So you're right. Doug's very good at saying things, and like I said, phrasing them in a way that kind of stirs people up. And hey, I'm not going to complain. It gets people to watch and listen.
Oh, sure, but you know what? Again, I've never met him. I'm not even sure E.J. Manuel met him. No, I'm just kidding. I've never met
him. You had to go there, didn't you?
All right. I've never met him. I've been told by everybody that I know that he knows that he's a great guy.
He's a remarkable dude. Great guy. I mean, you don't play for Jim Render and not have some good character qualities about you.
Exactly.
You mentioned Upper St. Clair. So, yeah, no, great guy. And still a very good dude. And he told us this morning on our show, it was, you know, hours after he had found out that he wasn't going to get the GM gig.
Yeah.
He was one of the
six
finalists. He was very humble, very kind, very congratulatory towards Omar Khan and towards Andy Weidl. Mm-hmm. And just very thankful to the Rooneys for the opportunity to even be involved in the process, because he's still got a gig with the XFL that he's still very excited about. They're involved with their player development and their football operations there as they kind of ramp up for next year.
Well, you could either work for, the Art Rooney the II, or you can work for The Rock. It's up to you.
I mean, it's not a bad pair to have to choose from, right?
It's not bad. It's not bad at all. The Pirates. No, all right. Let's just end on a positive note. All right.
Okay. to go there. You must have the game in the studio or something.
No.
Don't do it.
The Pirates are always that fallback joke. It's always great. But they retain Rust.
Mm-hmm.
They retain Rust on a 6-year deal, which you told me they were going to do. It sounds like they're still interested in retaining Malkin and Letang if they can. True?
Yeah, they do. And, it's funny, a week ago, it looked like all the writing was on the wall that Ron Hextall might be getting pushed out the side door. I think there was a little bit of a mini power play by some people that thought Hextall might not have been very interested in keeping Malkin and Letang. I don't know for sure who those people were. I do know that if Sidney Crosby were asked, he'd be very interested in retiring alongside Evgeny Malkin and Chris Letang, or at the very least, all of them finishing their careers in Penguin jerseys. So if he's being asked, then Sidney Crosby is very interested in that, and he does still carry some weight within that organization, as well he should. And so it seems to me now that Hextall has been given, I don't want to say the marching orders, but has been told by the Fenway Sports Group, the new owners of the Penguins, that, listen, we still want to compete for cups as long as Sidney Crosby is playing like he did this year, as long as Chris Letang is healthy and playing like he did this year. We're going to try and keep the band together as long as we can. Their first line's going to come back intact with Gensel, Crosby, and now Rust. They may have to skimp a bit on some of those depth pieces. You know, the Evan Rodriguez's of the world, may not be back, or they may, they may bring back even cheaper versions of them to fill out those bottom two lines around Jeff Carter and Teddy Bluger, because they've got the depth down the middle at center still. The big question that I think a lot of people have is, if you're going to keep Letang and Malkin, and you're willing to acknowledge that limits what you can do with your depth forwards, or the acquisition of some other depth forwards, because secondary scoring was a problem for them all year. When the first line wasn't able to produce, no one was able to produce, really. Then how are you going to be able to address the other goaltending position? Tristan Jarry is going into the final year of his contract. You didn't get an opportunity to see if he had really, truly, mentally recovered from the playoff loss to the Islanders in 21. So you need to have, I think, a really strong veteran complement, or maybe not even a veteran complement, but a really strong complement, a really strong 1B to Jarry's 1A. Naturally, when that topic comes up, the topic of Marc-Andre Fleury comes up, because he's a free agent, and there are rumblings he might be willing to take a quote-unquote hometown discount. Because he loves Pittsburgh so much and his family loves the area. I don't know, even if he takes a huge hometown discount, if once they get Letang and Malkin back on the books, they'd be able to do that, because the give and take, the yin and the yang of any possible Malkin or Letang deals is going to be term versus average annual value. I can't imagine Ron Hextall nor anyone else in the organization is comfortable going longer than 3 or 4 years with those guys, which means you're probably going to have to pay them a higher salary. And if you do that with both of those guys, you know, if you're going 3 years, $7 million apiece for Malkin, or $6.5 million apiece, you're going 4 years and $9 million apiece for Letang, well, you've just very quickly eaten up two-thirds of your remaining cap space going into next year. And going out and shopping for a strong 1B complement to your 1A goaltender kind of goes out the window.
Absolutely. You know, the only part about the family group that concerns me is they mentioned Hextall, Devers, Bogarts, and Martinez. And I'm like, no, they can't skip. it's a concern.
Hey, you know what? If they can play on the penalty kill, maybe.
They're all offensive guys. You and I both know it. All right. So, my friend, thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
No, thank you, Steve. Always enjoy joining you.
That's Chris Mack in Pittsburgh. Next half hour, Donnie Collins. We'll talk name, image, and likeness. The suit's favorite topic. He just doesn't understand why he personally can't get any traction with it. As we continue here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.